The wonders of time and space. Myths and legends. Strange realms and beings. It's Through the Wormhole with Morgan Freeman. Oh wait, no it isn't. It's Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio.
You see things.
Yeah.
I don't know where I am.
In the space that's outside of the physical reality.
Experience an unusual experience. I call them movies.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Would start moving. Zip from one place to the other.
And he showed me a number of things. He showed me some episodes from a few of my previous lives.
The moment he discovered his first role, Morgan Freeman realized he would never care about the real world ever again.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Anomalous Realities. I'm your host, Shaman Lenita Elder, and with us this week in studio is Mark and Melina. Mark, how are you doing?
Good evening. Yeah, good to be back on a Friday night at the end of the week.
Yeah, very much so. Melina, how are you doing this week?
Great. Happy Friday, everyone. Glad to be here.
And I know last week was a little different for everyone. I think Patrick jumped in for us and saved the day with the show. We were away, as per se. My daughter got married last Saturday, and last Friday night, I was just crazy busy with just preparing for her wedding, and I thought I could manage doing the show and the other, but it just didn't turn out to be something, you know, that was doable.
Fair enough. Well, it was wedding. How was that?
It was wonderful. I mean, it was small, you know, and that was, you know, how she planned it. We had it up on the overlook. Here in our community, it's a nice community, and we have an overlook that overlooks the Illinois River, and it's way up high, and it's really nice, and it was large enough that we were able to have the ceremony up there and all of the guests, and it was hot. It was so hot.
But it looked like a wooded area, if I remember.
Yes, it is.
There must have been a bit of nice shade as well.
Yeah, actually, for the listeners, you know, if you guys want to actually see the spot, and there's actually a couple of pictures on Twitter. So if you check out the Anomalous Realities Twitter, it's at Nita Who, NitaWho, and there's actually a picture of the overlook up there, and I think I put one of my girls up there too. So, yeah, if you guys want to check that out. But the overlook was just gorgeous. But, you know, we're in Oklahoma, and it's just so hot right now this time of year. You know, this week has been a little bit of a break because it's been kind of rainy and cloudy all week. But last week it was, you know, in the triple digits all week long. So it was just sweltering. And they were anxious to get the ceremony over. You could see the sweat was just pouring down their poor faces, and I did the best I could because I don't know that I've ever mentioned this, but I'm actually ordained. I'm a reverend, so I actually officiated the ceremony for them. I did that for my son and his wife as well, and it's kind of become, I guess, a tradition. My kids like to have their mom, you know, be their minister for their weddings. So, yeah, I didn't get to sit and watch her. I actually got to be the one to connect them together, which I think is almost as special. You know, it's one of those magical things. You know, you get to be a part of the joining of, you know, your child to another person, and it's magical. Yeah,
definitely. And they were happy with that as well, which makes it even better.
Yes, definitely. So,
congratulations.
Oh, thank you. It's yeah. So that was a good thing this week, and you know, but we've had some interesting things in the news, not just this week but this month. And so, you know, we were kind of going to talk about that. So far for this week, earlier this week, a bunch of people in Los Angeles and Las Vegas and that whole area, were calling in about these flashes of light and what looked like, you know, like a comet or a meteor or something. They saw this big ball of fire. Actually, a lot of people saw two balls of fire in the sky. And then they broke up into like lots of pieces. And so, you know, there were just numerous videos. I mean, like videos upon videos upon videos. It, like everybody was outside and saw this, which is really rare. You know, most sightings of this kind of nature, you're lucky if, you know, a few people had the foresight to get their cameras out. But apparently a lot of people were outside on this night. And there are just lots and lots of videos of this from all different angles and all different qualities. And well, to me, it looked like a meteor. And for a long time, there was no official word as to what it was. But
Good footage, definitely.
Yeah. But,
the BBC are saying that it's a rocket sighting.
Yeah, that's what the official story is that came from spaceweather.com.
But it does look a bit like a meteor as well.
Look more like a meteor because there were two large pieces. If you look at the video, there were two large balls of light, not one at the first part of it. And as it broke up, lots and lots of small pieces. But apparently this was supposedly the body of China's experimental Long March 7 rocket, which re-entered Earth's atmosphere. I guess it was Wednesday night at around 9:38 p.m., which is when these sightings were coming in. So it created a giant fireball over most of the western United States. A glowing trail was spotted in Utah, Nevada, and most of California. But here's the thing. Why did it come in over the United States? This is the thing that I don't think anybody's really asking about, but shouldn't we be a little bit concerned that China's rocket is coming back in? It's re-entering through over our country, over through the United States. Mark, it's not your country, but you know what I'm saying. I find it interesting that there wasn't any heightened security over this. I mean, it is a rocket. It's a piece of a rocket. Why is it re-entering over our country? They don't really cover in the story on space weather exactly why, you know, its re-entry happened over the U.S. If it was intentional, if it was an accident, you know, what happened there. There were people that thought it was the old space station that was, you know, coming back in or something, but I don't know. It's a
pretty epic explosion. Or an event into space is what they classify it as.
Uh-huh, yeah, which is interesting. And then the following night, right, and then we had a meteor shower last night, which was huge. I wanted to stay up for it, but I'm just too old. It's like, it's supposed to be 2 to 3 a.m., 2 to 3 a.m., and I'm like, you know what, I'd really love to, but I can't do it.
Don't feel bad because I couldn't make it to that either.
Yeah. Were you wanting to as well?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just, you know, it's one of those things because I used to, you know, I used to stay up late for the meteor showers and yeah, I can't do it. Did you see it at all? Were you able to see it over in the UK, the meteor shower?
Not that I know of, but I was looking out the window last night, but I didn't spot anything.
UFOs either?
No, unfortunately not. I'll stick my head out again tonight. No. Well, last week, after I mentioned it, we had a little break, as it were, I did go down the coast, do a bit of camping in the end, but it was sort of cloudy weather at the night in the evening, so I missed out on some stars and that. But, but here it's been, it's clear night again tonight, and I don't know, do you know what the name of the meteorite shower is?
The Perseid. Perseid, yeah.
These normally go on for a couple of nights.
They do, yeah. As a matter of fact, it's going on for a while.
But that rocket sighting was before then, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was before that. You know, it's so crazy because, you know, that was actually what my thinking was, what we were seeing, you know, when I was looking at those videos, as it looked like a massive meteor shower, like a big one, you know.
Yeah, it's interesting.
And then the next day, there was one.
That is an interesting type because, I mean, rocket misfires or whatever are becoming more common now. You know, remember the Norway spiral, was it, or something?
Oh, yeah.
But this is quite a frequent image now in the UFO
community. I never really bought that the Norway spiral was a rocket.
I didn't either.
I've seen rockets. It's similar, but there was something about that that was just so off.
That's fine, but then which is more similar to a rocket to you, this most recent sighting or like those spiral events?
Well, I think those are different because the spiral was more like a launch, whereas this was more like some sort of a re-entry, like a crashing back into the planet, you know?
That's a good
point. So it's a different, you know, stage, a different aspect of it. So they're two totally different, you know, things that you're perceiving. So I think each could be correct. You know, it definitely could have been the rocket. I think timing wise, according to what we know, it makes sense, but that wasn't reported until the day after it happened. So it could be cover story too. Who knows? It's one of those things. I'm always somewhat skeptical of the official stories because you know that they will, anytime something anomalous happens, they're always going to come up with a story to explain it away, or at least to attempt to explain it away immediately, to the best of their abilities. So who knows? You know, it could be the rocket. It could be something else. It could be the rocket was used as a cover story. But it was interesting. It didn't look like it was intelligently designed or anything. I mean, whatever it was definitely, you know, coming in as if it were crashing, you know, as if it were re-entering out of control. Just by the way it was, but it was rather slow, which meteors can be pretty slow when they come in. So it still felt like more like a meteor to me, but you know.
It did look like a scene from Deep Impact. Yes,
it kind of did, and that movie was a little scary.
Good footage. Glad that people caught it. A bit like the meteorite over that Russian town or whatnot, which blew out all the windows. I mean, that was another one of these events. Mm-hmm. And I know that was actually a meteorite, that one, but yeah. People got good videos of that as well. Amazing videos of that. I mean, you see that all over the place nowadays.
Yeah, apparently the world was supposed to end today, according to someone. my daughter.
Yeah, why was that?
I'm checking that out. There's some sort of doomsday theory about July 29th, and I'm getting the first story that I can find here. Crazy doomsday theory suggests that Earth will shatter tonight. A pole shift. That's what it is. Oh, okay. I'm so scared now. When a magnetic flip in our planet will coincide with the second coming of Jesus. What?
What?
The end time prophecies claim there's outstanding evidence that points to the fact that the world will face a catastrophic finish on July 29th. They're running out of time. I'm telling you that right now. I don't see the poles flipping yet. And this is a video apparently that surfaced probably on YouTube or something that suggested that, you know, the Bible explained that multiple catastrophes would occur and then what would happen afterwards. And I'm not going to watch this 18-minute video in the middle of my show. But, NASA has confirmed that it's highly unlikely that the magnetic poles will flip and end the world. The science behind this doesn't work.
Just out of curiosity, they're saying in the chat room that there was a 7.8 earthquake
below
Japan right now. It just happened.
Okay, guys, so. Get ready.
They've got a big one.
I'm getting ready. Okay, I wasn't logged into the chat room. I'm sorry, guys. I'm so sorry. I'm coming in now. Coming into the chat room. Oh, that's right. I registered. I've got to put in my password.
Pole shifting live.
Pole shifting live. So where is this earthquake happened?
Just below Japan.
Well, earthquakes happen in Japan all the time.
All the time.
I guess it's because it's on the Ring of Fire. And there was actually, here's the thing. I guess it was one of her coworkers that had brought this up to her. And this person was, I guess, pretty scared about it. She was pretty worried that, you know, it was actually going to happen. And one of the other people that she works with apparently had this dream, a sort of prophetic type of dream, in which I guess there was a massive devastation coming of some sort. So who knows, you know, had they already, you know, been thinking about this, you know, had they also read, you know, a story or watched a video about it, and perhaps that inspired their dream? I don't know. I did have a doomsday dream. I think it was around 97 or 99, something like that. It was the last part of the 90s in this dream. And actually, guys, this dream is actually widely responsible for why I live where I live right now. In the dream, there was a there were cloud cities, which were floating around, and they were monitoring what was left of the United States and civilization there. And I could actually, in the dream, I could actually like zoom out and see the planet. And there was a lot of the planet that was just covered in like molten lava and magma. And then there were like these islands of where mountains used to be, all over the place, that were where people were existing in these safe zones where it was, you know, tall enough and there was still land for people to exist on and live. And so people were grouped together in like communal, you know, groups, living, you know, in little communities. And as, you know, these people are living in the communities, and we were part of a small community, and we were, you know, you could look over the cliff and see the lava down below, but we would gradually, you know, every so often we would see these ships come by that were like cloud cities. I don't know how else to explain it. They were like floating cities, basically, and they were monitoring us, and we understood they were monitoring us, and they were making sure that we were fine. So yeah, I had that dream late 90s, and I knew in the dream where I was, and it's in this area that I am now, which is the Ozarks, the foothills of the Ozarks. And so yeah, I kind of made it a point to stay in this area, because you know, when you have different dreams, some dreams stay with you and some you just forget almost instantly. This was one of those that stayed with me. You ever had those dreams?
Oh, yeah, all the time. The dreams where there seems to be an underlying message.
Something more.
To it.
Yeah. Yeah. Sometimes I think you could be seeing your past lives. They could also be, I think sometimes we can see other timelines. Okay, we have a call coming in, so I'm going to bring in. Hello, caller.
Yes, this is Revolutionary Radio.
Yes, it is. How are you doing?
I'm hanging in here, and I was going to ask you, where can I get a, you know, because I'm severely disabled. With a life-threatening electro-hypersensitivity. Might have the same thing. And I've been in the courts for several years. And let me tell you, perjury filed in the courts to conceal that this condition is being caused by the wireless devices in schools.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah. I wanted to know if you know of any of the hosts that would allow me to at least some space to explain this tribulation.
What would you like to explain?
I'm sorry?
What is it that you want to explain?
Basically, you know, that there is an attempt to conceal that the wireless devices inside the school are causing children severe physical harm. And
oh, my goodness. I'll tell you something right now. I've heard stories similar to this before. I know that wireless devices actually can interrupt your sleep, and they can cause you to have anxiety. I've heard things like this before, so I thank you for sharing that with our listeners. Most certainly, it is an important message. Very much so. Thank you very much, caller.
Yes, but do you know anybody that may have, you know, that may allow me to, you know, to explain more or less this type of condition?
I don't. I'm sorry. I wish I could help you with that.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for calling.
Bye-bye.
All right. We are very sorry about that, but we had a very large technical problem with that, and we lost the complete call when we lost our caller. I'm not even sure how that happened, and it took me a minute to get the studio back. So I will bring Mark and Melina back in real quick. And goodness, I don't even know what happened there. That was crazy, crazy, crazy. Just like lost everything, and I couldn't even get anything to close or do anything. It was completely, it was really messed up. So we're back. Mark, are you back?
Yep.
Okay. Melina, are you with us?
I'm here.
Okay. We're back. That was bizarre. That was really, really strange. It was a very interesting topic though. Very interesting topic that we had. It's weird because it looks like, and here's the strange thing. It bugged Skype to the point that it looks like the other call still exists, which is really weird. I can't get rid of it. It's so strange. I don't know. It's weird.
It jumped onto a new timeline.
Yeah. Well, I was just talking about that before the caller came in, you know, about how some dreams could maybe be actually a peek at an alternative universe, like an alternative life that we're living almost simultaneously, you know.
A probably more interesting one. Well, in my case. I don't know.
My life's pretty interesting most of the time. Even though...
Yeah, but flying and, you know, the non-apocalyptic side of your dreams. it's a nice thought.
Non-apocalyptic, yeah. Some of them are a little out there, I think. You know, I've had some that are, I definitely think, are on other planets. Maybe a previous life where I was not living. Okay. I'm being told that, what I experienced with that call is, I'm talking to Patrick, and we might have actually had a problem there. So hopefully we can get rid of that other and be done with that, because that was not good. That was a very interesting topic, though. You know, on the topic of what the caller was talking about, that is legitimate, in that I have heard that, you know, the wireless signals do cause problems for people. I've heard that it makes people lose sleep. It can give them anxiety and all sorts of problems. Have you guys heard that at all? Because
I have. I've heard that it's even affecting like the vegetation and the trees around it can be affected.
Yep. And I know it used to exist with mobile phone masts. It had a name. It even had its own name. That conspiracy about cell phone towers, it had its own name, but I can't remember.
What was it called?
I wrote a short story about that stuff once.
Did you really?
What is it?
Huh.
But I don't know how far it goes down to, but I mean, yeah, I think your mobile phone can definitely control your mood while you're asleep in a way.
Right.
Even just the unaudible electrical hum will be probably getting in tune in some way with your brain.
Wow.
Of course, if you leave it out the room, you'll probably be all right. But I mean, yeah. you know how you sometimes instinctively wake up before a text comes in.
And, yes.
And
yeah.
You feel a call coming in if you really go that far.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you do maybe wake up just a little second before. And where the hell does that intuition come from? It must be from
maybe sensing the electronic signal.
But
you know, our bodies have their own fields, but yeah, I don't know.
And we, you know, this is still like the cell phone stuff, definitely. I know they've found out it's majority safe, but it's still
right.
Early days for this stuff. We've only lived with technology next to our head for like 10 years. Well, I don't know.
Well, I think that's why so many people are using, you know, Bluetooth and other devices also instead of holding the phones up to their heads, because there's been a lot of evidence, lots of links of, you know, cancer to our cell phones.
Yes, that's bad. And it's people are a bit ditzy as well. I mean, if Google Glasses, for example, were to catch on, I mean, you see people make enough mistakes with just their mobile phones. So.
Mm-hmm. Can you imagine?
Oh, that guy, that happened the other week, didn't it? One of the Tesla electric cars went into the back of a lorry or something.
I heard about that.
And so that's always a good start.
Yeah, it's not. You almost wonder if there was something there too, you know, because I know that they don't want that technology to go forward, so maybe they're sabotaging it.
Oh, yes, what we're going to talk about. Something related to that, aren't we?
Sort of.
Well, it's in that realm, you're right. It's technologies that don't want to be information that doesn't.
Yes, information that doesn't.
Isn't allowed.
Speaking of which, we have had some losses recently. And, you know, I've got an article here about. It talks about the recent deaths of two UFO hunters within the last month. Okay. And the thing is I guess a lot of people are actually thinking that Men in Black are responsible for this. Now, I don't know if you guys have been hearing about this and what your thoughts are on this, but I know that the Men in Black have been one of those... urban legends that have been around much, much longer than most people realize. The film was based on stories that have been coming forward since, I think, the 1960s, 1970s, perhaps even a little bit before that. But as far as to my knowledge, the stories of Men in Black go back way, way, way. We're talking, you know, 40, 50 years. Anytime someone would have a UFO sighting, these Men in Black would show up, and they were usually described as being very robotic, almost like they seemed to have no emotion. And I think that's why people thought that perhaps they weren't actually human, because that was actually stated many times in reports that people had who had interacted with them. But they were often told they didn't see what they thought they saw. They couldn't tell people about it, that they shouldn't tell people about it, and that they felt very much like they had been threatened, you know, in a very indirect way, but that they had been basically told either you keep your mouth shut or else. And so I don't know that there's any direct correlation with these deaths and the Men in Black, but apparently there are a lot of people that are making that correlation. Have you heard anything about this, Mark?
I haven't, no, but a couple of weeks ago I remember asking David Marler about whether any of his sort of recent cases that involved Men in Black or sort of government officials coming out of thin air, but he didn't. So
no.
if this the way you make it sound, it's just people connecting dots that maybe are only half there.
Right. Well, you know, what is his name now? I can't think. Dan Aykroyd. He had pulled together all of the footage. He had purchased and put together all of the footage from the Chicago O'Hare incident, which is a very well-known incident. It was huge because it happened at Chicago O'Hare Airport, which is one of the largest airports in the United States. And he was supposed to be putting it into a documentary. I would love to have him on the show, by the way, but I've heard he's very hard to get an interview with. all of a sudden, you know, he just went quiet on it. And from what I've heard through the grapevine is that he was visited by people in black, unmarked vehicles who would park at the end of his driveway and sometimes get out and just kind of stand there and stare and just, I guess he just really felt intimidated. And he got to the point where he just didn't feel it was, you know, worth it.
Mm.
So he backed away from that.
Wow, is my understanding.
Yeah. Look it up because there's information out there about this. And I would love to talk to the man and get the whole story from, you know, from the horse's mouth, so to speak.
It would, you know, how high up would it have to be if it was us, if it was our government, one of our governments or something like that, you know, for it to be unmarked cars, untraceable.
Yeah.
It just boggles the mind that
we know that they're trying to keep everything silent, but what if it wasn't even the government? What if it was, you know, there are a lot of people that don't feel the Men in Black are government agents, that they are actually extraterrestrially sent. So what if, I don't think they're trying to keep it quiet though. I don't think they are. When, you know, you hear the stories about extraterrestrials that have tried to make contact and tried to help us, it doesn't really seem like they're trying to keep their existence a secret. I think it's the government that does. So I don't know. And I'm wondering what, you know, if these recent deaths, I mean, two deaths in a month's time is a little bit of a, you know, a little bit too much to just pass it off as nothing. The first was Max Spires, who was a paranormal investigator and a UFO hunter. He was also famous, guys, listen to this, for telling the world that he used to belong to an elite secret group of government-sanctioned super soldiers. His dead body was discovered in Poland this month, and many conspiracy theorists are speculating that he was murdered for knowing or perhaps saying too much. Now, if he was actually a part of an elite secret group of super soldiers, or he, you know, this whole thing of him being murdered because, and here's the other thing that adds to it, is the fact that the authorities have not yet released his cause of death. It has not been stated what he died of or how he died, just that his body was discovered. So this man, who is a paranormal investigator, a UFO hunter, and claims to be a part of an elite secret group of super soldiers, is found dead. And they're not saying anything on how he died or anything else about it. This tells me there's something more going on here. And then 2 days ago, another UFO hunter died, and this is being ruled as a suicide. His name was Gaurav Tiwari, and he was found dead in his Northwest India home. He was a newlywed, so he had just gotten married. Everyone says he was at a good point in his life, but his death is being called a suicide. But again, there's not really been a actual cause of death so far. Apparently, his father heard a loud noise from the bathroom. When he went to check, he said that he was unresponsive. Law enforcement reports say that there was a black line wrapped around his neck, which led authorities to believe he had hanged or strangled himself. But wouldn't there be some evidence of that in the place where he was found? Another theory is that he might have fatally hit his head. Once again, though, we have another mysterious death with no known cause of a UFO hunter. Are these people getting too close? Are they figuring out too much? What's happening here? I mean, this is what we've got to look at, guys, because, you know, we have to take these things seriously. My dog is freaking out.
Yeah, well, that is a shame. Sorry to hear about these UFO guys. Doesn't everyone claim they're a UFO hunter these days?
Well,
I'm not trying to be nasty to them. I'm just saying, like,
No, but I think they're both pretty well known. That's the thing, is that they're actually pretty well known.
Mm.
And that's kind of, I think, the reason that, you know, in their circles, they were pretty well known. I think the thing that, you know, piques my curiosity the most is that that the one guy claimed to be part of, you know, this elite group of super soldiers. It's not the first time I've heard someone say that they were a part of, you know, a high profile, top secret organization that we don't know about. It isn't the first time at all.
And there's probably not much evidence to support it, but you could find probably
more
evidence.
Well, if he turns up dead, that's some evidence.
Yeah, but Lenita, you could probably prove 10 times over that the poor guy had depression or something. Right? Yet people will hold on to that.
Well, now Max isn't the one that was being caught. That wasn't suicide. That wasn't Max. The one that said he was part of the super soldiers has no cause of death so far.
Exactly. So that means suicide is still
possible.
One of the possible options.
I'll tell you something, Marky. Though,
mm-hmm.
I had a guest on one of when we were doing ATS radio, and this was when we were doing Out of the Box, and had a guest who is an author, and he is one of my favorite authors. Actually, he does a lot of series that are considered science fiction, fantasy, and he has a series that is called Area 51 series. He has another series that's called the Atlantis series, and then he's got the Psychic Warrior series. This man is a former Green Beret Special Forces, and during the interview, he had mentioned that he was actually a part of, you've heard of The Men Who Stare at Goats, the movie? Mm-hmm. Okay, yep. That was real. That actually happened. He was a part of it. He was active during that time frame, and he actually went into detail about, you know, things that worked, things that didn't work. But one of the things that he said to me that has always stuck with me, and if you read his books, you'll understand why. He said 85% of what he writes in his novels is true. Now, you've got to pick up some of his books. His name is Bob Mayer, and he writes about a space force. He writes about a lot of things that interdimensional things that the Bermuda Triangle is actually a dimensional portal of sorts that connects us with other alternate parallel universe realities. If even a fraction of this stuff is true, it is mind-boggling, to say the least. And for him to actually say on radio that 85% of what he writes is true was a huge risk for him to do. But this is a man who was a part of an elite group. And he did write about super soldiers as this man described that said he was a part of. So I worry a little bit about his safety, honestly. But knowing that people like him exist and are willing to come forward, it helps, I think, the community at large to know that there are people that are on the inside out there that are willing to do what they can within their limits to help bring the truth forward without putting themselves at dire risk. He did as much as he could. There were things he couldn't say, you know, and there were questions I wouldn't ask because I knew not to push certain boundaries because I didn't want to put him in danger. But in the same token, we, I think, need to really think about what is happening around us right now. Because, I mean, these aren't the only paranormal investigators and UFO hunters that have mysteriously died. And it actually, in the article I read, it said that these were just the latest in a string of over 70 mysterious deaths involving UFO researchers, investigators, authors, alien contactees, and military who had come forward. What I'd really like is if they had actually, you know, given the list of the 70, you know, mysterious deaths so that you could actually have something say, you know, here's this, all these people. Because you can't just say something like, you know, a string of 70 mysterious deaths and not at least give some names so that you back up your claim. Because that was the thing about it that bothered me. They could have at least provided some more names so that it would give some more weight to what they were saying.
Yeah. Slightly unrelated, but I remember a local case of this man that came home one night and unfortunately was found dead in the morning. And they like found this toxin or something in him, like 500 times the normal limit. Like you couldn't even ingest this amount, and they just had found it in him. So what the hell? How did that? How did he come home, go to bed with his wife, and then wake up dead the next morning with this stuff that is so foreign? And that was near the time of my first UFO sighting. So that was like a freaky coincidence. Like, oh my God, what the hell? So by which I'm saying, I just can only imagine the depths things possibly go within like areas like super soldiers and things.
Yeah.
It's one of the offshoots of the paranormal. I don't know. I'm not going to pretend I know anything really about that sort of stuff. But if you say like the chap's a green beret, then I presume it's similar to, you know, like lieutenants or whatnot in the RAF and that see UFOs. And they're people that you definitely... listen up to.
Yeah. When I was talking to him, you know, I asked him, you know, if he wrote, you know, because of his experiences, but he was a writer before he got into the military. So, and that was just kind of something that he always, you know, continued to do. And they say, write what you know. So you write what you know. So he wrote what he knew. It's interesting because, there's a series on A&E right now that I've actually been watching, thanks to Nighthawk, called The American West. And there were some things about that that he actually wrote about in his books as well that suggested that there was more to certain battles in history than we might have known, you know, which is very interesting. I'm thinking that was in the Atlantis books. I'm not sure which one. But they talked about, I think, Little Bighorn. The Battle of Little Bighorn was one of them, I'm pretty sure. And he actually talked about a lot of stuff that it made you think. It made you go,
Well, it's a modern equivalent, effectively, of divine intervention by the sound of it.
You think?
Well, in a way, it's like that. I mean, that is specifically related to Jesus and stuff, I guess, but this is the...
Well, now, if we're going back to Jesus, we're going back to the fact that we're all going to die tonight.
Well, it's already Saturday here, so I'm still alive.
Yeah, so I guess it's, you know, in which time zone are we supposed to all die on the 29th? I don't know. That's a good question there. I guess they have... several more hours still until the last place is no longer on Friday, theoretically.
My point was, though, is that, yeah, battles, that would be pretty cool to think there was some sort of divine intervention amongst some of those. But, well, you would have your own ideas about the Battle of Bighorn, is it, or something?
Little Bighorn.
Little Big Adventure. You... probably
that series opened a lot of wounds for me, honestly. It does. As a Native American, when you watch these things being reenacted, and I want to say that, you know, people don't really understand the pain that you feel, even when it's in relation to your ancestors' pain. There's a link between yourself and your ancestors. For people who are open to it, when you're spiritually connected to everything, and I would hope that everyone has this to some extent, but you have this link to not only your immediate family, but to those that have come before you, and to watch your ancestors be subjected to the things that they've been subjected to, the horrors, it's extremely painful, and it's very hard to watch sometimes. I know there was a Tom Cruise movie that, and it was a very short part of the film, The Last Samurai, that dealt with just some of the things that the American military did to my ancestors. But I remember just being overwhelmed in tears, and I had to pause the movie before I could continue watching it because I just was overwhelmed with emotion from all of it, even though it was a film, you know, even though it's a fictional thing, you feel that connection, and it's very difficult. It's very difficult. And I know part of it is being an empath, because I'm an empath. Most healers are empaths. You have to be able to feel other people's pain in order to heal them. That's just the nature of healing. In order to heal someone else, you have to be able to empathize with them. You have to be able to feel their pain. So perhaps for someone who already is very sensitive to the emotions of others, it's worse. I don't know. But for me, watching those kind of things is very difficult. So, yeah.
Well, absolutely. But then your feelings are your feelings. But that's what I'm getting at. What about then, when someone then comes and says, and actually that was super soldiers doing that. does that not make you go a bit crazy? A bit
well,
like
9/11. That wasn't what he said. That wasn't what he wrote about. You'd have to read it. The super soldier thing is something else. And, you know, you have to take into consideration that the things that we're told about history aren't necessarily true. History, you know, is widely in the hands of the people who are telling the story. And it's very easily changed by those people, you know, depending on who's around to contest it. I'll give you an example. In the program, The American West, there was a there was a section where the president decided to break his treaty with the Native Americans because there was gold in the hills where they had given them as a reservation. And when they realized there was gold there, they asked them to move somewhere else. And when they refused because it was their sacred land, the narrator said that the president had no choice but to break the treaty. He had no choice. There's always a choice. He had a choice. He made the choice. That wasn't his only choice. He had the option to be honorable and not break the treaty just because there was gold there. He had a choice. And the fact that they phrased it that way, they did it so that it would make people empathetic with his decision and to make them feel like it was the right decision to make. That whole phrasing, what they said, was very deliberate to make people see it in the light that they were presenting it in rather than what it actually was. So that's what I'm saying. You guys get that?
Well, Mel stepped out, but yeah, I understand that.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry that they affect you that badly, these programs.
Well, you know, it's not like, I don't know how to explain it. You know, it's a temporary thing, you know. It's just, like I said, it just kind of stirs up old wounds in a way. I don't know, perhaps I'm, you know, feeling effects of past lives, you know. Maybe there are memories that are waiting to be, you know, awoken up there. I've actually never done the past life regression, which I have a lot of friends that do it, so I don't know why I haven't done it yet. I'm actually going to learn how to do that so that I can do it for people as well, because I want to be able to help people heal in that way. You know, there's a lot of, well, here's the thing, Mark. There's a lot of things that we have in our current life that are, they're a result of our past lives, from traumas in our past lives. Fears that we have often stem from something that we've experienced in a previous life.
So, yeah, I've been thinking about this more, but I don't know if I want to think about this more.
Really?
But that's cool. No, well, see, you've mentioned it, past lives, and it's not something I'd really consciously thought about until I started doing this with you. But
yeah,
but more recently I have thought about it, and yeah, I don't know if I like the concept, is what I'm saying. I don't have a problem with the concept, is if half of what you're saying is true, I don't like what I did. You know?
We have to have different experiences in each life, which means sometimes we had to be the bad guy, you know? Sometimes we have to be the person that perhaps, you know, we wouldn't, you know, we'd be at odds with in this life, or that we try to protect people from in this life. We can't all be the Prince of Arabia, you know, or the Queen of Egypt in every life or something like that. Everybody would love to just, you know, have every past life they were some great and wonderful person, but that's not the reality of it, because in order to have a balance of experiences, in order for a soul to progress to the next level, to the next frequency, to the next vibration, you have to have a full range of experiences. You have to be able to experience all of the range of things that there are, including cruelty, including pain, you know, everything. So we have to go through it at one point in time in our soul's journey. We all have to be there. And sometimes, you know, I'm sure there was a life where I was a man and not a woman. You were probably a female in one of your, you know, past lives. It's just a fact. It doesn't affect who you are in this life to some extent. I almost wonder sometimes if, you know, some of the confusions that we have is, you know, people don't know who they are in this life is because maybe there's bleeding over from their past lives that's, you know, affecting them in this life. You know, it's possible. It's one of those things that I don't think a lot of people have considered, you know, when they feel really, I guess, lost or confused, you know, where they're going in their lives.
Yeah, that's a good idea. I like that.
So you think you're going to do or interested in maybe doing a regression one of these days, Mark? You working your way up to it?
Not sure I'd like what I'd find.
Well...
Yeah, that sounds interesting. I will keep that in mind.
Yeah.
No plans to, but yeah.
Yeah.
I want to get a bit more into that. Past lives.
Yeah. There's you know, there's been lots of people who actually are able to pinpoint, you know, memories and things from past lives, which is very fascinating, because theoretically, when we come into this new life, you know, there's like a veil that you get, you know, that... kind of prevents you from remembering what happened before. So it lets you start new experiences with nothing affecting it. But for some people, I guess the veil wasn't thick enough. I don't know. Because some people are ever actually able to remember, although usually it only happens in childhood. So that's another thing. You know what's funny is we should be at break right now. And...
No, it's still 1 minute.
Is it?
Warning. Warning.
Huh?
Advertising detected. Please stand by.
And cue advertising music. Did. No?
I think there's something up with the server tonight. So we might get an uninterrupted.
I reckon. Evening. I still think we've got 30 seconds till the adverts start going.
I don't know. It says it's... 3 minutes till for me.
We might just be Skyping ourselves. We know.
Oh, no, that would be awful. No, they can hear us. You guys can hear us, right?
Right.
Call in. We certainly hope so. Yeah, call in and let us know that you actually hear us. You have our call-in numbers available? I can pull them up if not.
Oh, after the break, we will have a call-in number.
If we have a break.
If we have a break. We've already crashed out twice.
Well, for those of you, well, the numbers are on the website, and they're also in the chat room. They've got the numbers at the top of the chat room. So if you go to the chat room, you'll see it. For Studio B, it's 310-421-4053. And, of course, it's always Freedom Screen 2, which is the way you can call in via Skype. So let us know if you're actually hearing us out there, guys, because we don't know what's going on here. But we should have had commercial ads come in any minute ago, and they didn't come in.
Well, you see, I've got different times on all my clocks. I've got 5:02, I've got 2 minutes to, 6 minutes to. So what have you got?
I've got 2 minutes till. So I for certain, yeah, we should have gone to break. So hey, we got a night where we don't have any commercials. But since we don't have commercials, I'll automatically go into our weekly mention of the station. Guys, you know that we are here, courtesy of Revolution Radio on freedomslips.com. And it's not cheap. Servers aren't cheap. So if you appreciate the show, if you enjoy listening, if you're having fun with all of our weirdness and our strange warnings and our talk about the UFOs and, unfortunately, the deaths, the mysterious deaths of UFO hunters and paranormal investigators and mysterious lights seen above the West Coast and all of these topics, if you enjoy listening to it, just spend a couple of bucks, you know, what you'd spend on some Starbucks or something. Go to the website, click on the donate button or the support button, and give a little bit to the station to help them alleviate the server costs and stuff. You can also help by purchasing seed packs, which our station owner, he grows them all himself. He's an organic farmer, and it's a great cause. So, yeah, guys, you know, just take a minute and, you know, give what you can, even if it's just a few dollars. Everything helps. So, and we have Melina back with us. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we normally do this at the top of the hour, and now it's the top of the hour. So, Marky, can we play something fun? What do you have for us tonight?
Sorry, yes. Yes, yeah. I can.
What will we be doing?
So it's 2 a.m. Well, need the motivation of all that applause, you know.
Yay!
And now back to here's your host. Okay, yeah, there are a couple of things we could do tonight, maybe.
Excellent.
TopicBot is around and is as crap as always, so we could do that first. not many topics tonight, but.
Okay.
Pre-activating subroutines. Connecting to AOL. Waiting. Waiting. Still waiting. Success.
Ta-da.
Topic bot is now connected and online. Awaiting command.
So, this is, as always, just a few random topics, one of which you actually covered slightly earlier. Okay. But it's just a chance to discuss
like a quick fire.
Alert, interesting topic found. The Bermuda Triangle.
Oh, okay. All right, Melina, I'll let you lead with this.
Well, the Bermuda Triangle, I've always found the Bermuda Triangle interesting. It's probably one of the first anomalous things as a child that, you know, I'd heard about when I was a kid was the Bermuda Triangle. And I've always thought that it is, like you said before, it's a rift between two different places where we can, well, people have found that, well, back to you, Lenita.
We can, like, connect with other realities or other places and times. You know, I always thought it was just like a time, you know, like a time-space rift. But it seems like there's more to it than that. So it seems like it's more than just, a, you know, a, a rift in time and space, but it also seems to be perhaps dimensions, which is very, very curious. I mean, it's piqued my curiosity, him, you know, saying that most of what he writes is true because of that, because, you know, each choice we make, especially on a larger scale, like our presidents, for instance, will create a different timeline, a different reality based on those. So our choices can feasibly create alternative realities of our world. And the interesting thing was that in his books, he describes one of the worlds finding a way to, I guess, basically go to any of the realities that they choose to at will, that they had this ability. One of the things I found interesting about this was the means that they used to enter our world were these spherical devices that came through, these craft that they would travel in, because one was blue and the other was gold, and they were from two different realities apparently. But the gold one reminded me a lot of the UFO sighting. Remember, I've mentioned to you guys before about the gold sphere that we saw. And so when I was reading about this in his book, it kind of freaked me out a little bit, because, you know, this dimensional vehicle that he mentioned sound a lot like what we had seen. Of course, this isn't the first time that I, you know, that someone else had actually described this craft. As I said, when I explained it, I think it was on when David was on, that a year later, you know, it was on the movie Sphere with Michael Crichton, that Michael Crichton had written about. And I'm sure the book had come long beforehand, but it made me wonder, you know, where his inspiration, you know, for the sphere and the concept of the book came from. Had he had a personal experience with one of these craft? It really made me think about it. But, you know, the Bermuda Triangle was one of the very first mysteries that I ever looked into as a child. As soon as I had access to books beyond, you know, the Disney storybooks that my mother got me when I was growing up, as soon as I had access to a library, the first books I would check out were things that were mysterious, paranormal. I was immediately pulled to it because these were things that I was more familiar with, you know, stories about ghosts, stories about things that people didn't understand, because I had experienced so many things in my life that other people didn't understand. So it was naturally a draw for me. So one of the first books I picked up was the Bermuda Triangle book that was written by Charles Berlitz. Have you ever read that one, Melina?
I believe so.
Yeah. I think that was like, I think he was, you know, like the authority on the Bermuda Triangle many, many years ago. And I remember as a child, I was probably like 10 years old, thinking how awesome it would be to meet the man that wrote this book that had done so much research on this topic. I was a nerd fangirl from my earliest ages. And I'm like that today, you know. I mean, who are my rock stars? My rock stars are Graham Hancock, Giorgio Tsoukalos, you know, Eric Von Daniken, who is, you know, I've met two of those people. And so for me, that was huge to meet Giorgio and to meet Eric. And that was big for me. I mean, it was awesome. And they're awesome people. I mean, they're really great. And to be able to sit down and talk to people who were my intellectual heroes for such a long time was absolutely amazing. And of course, I'm going off on a tangent again, but back to the Bermuda Triangle. I think the things that struck me about the triangle so much when I was reading about it were not just the disappearances, because disappearances, you know, could be for so many different reasons, but for the mysterious missing people when they did find remains of certain, you know, things, they'd come back and there would be no one there, you know, like everyone just vanished. That was one of the things, and also the fog, which, intriguingly, the yellow fog that was mentioned in many of those accounts was also mentioned in his books. So, yeah, coming around to all of it, there is said to be a giant crystal pyramid under the ocean in the center of the Bermuda Triangle. I don't know that anybody's successfully ever able to get any real footage of it, but that's one of those things that has been stated for some time, and I don't know if we're going to ever have any, you know, hardcore evidence of it, but that would be interesting to see. So we can do another topic now, Mark.
Alert. Interesting topic. Found.
Is it?
Cloning. No. Cloning. 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 Cloning.
Cloning. Cloning. Oh. I don't think that we should, you know, like, I know that in the news I've read recently that they're going to be cloning or trying to clone a woolly mammoth. And I don't know how I feel about taking things that nature naturally selected to be extinct and bringing them back to life. I'm not sure how comfortable I am with that type of technology, with pretending you're God.
Yeah. Yeah. It's something that's been done before. Cloning is something that that has been done before. I think that, I guess not per se cloning. I'm not sure that there's evidence of cloning, but definitely genetic modification there's evidence of in our past. Cloning, I'm not so sure that people have actually been cloned. However, if you talk to people who have the multiple pictures of Keanu Reeves throughout history, they say he's either a vampire or a clone, right? You've seen those?
I've seen those, yeah.
Yeah. It's actually pretty interesting, you know, how many people have doppelgangers, you know, from the past. But when you look at families, I mean, you look at pictures of parents and their children, I mean, these characteristics follow family lineages, you know. You see it all the time. I mean, I put up a picture of my daughter and myself, and, you know, I didn't see it when she was little, but now she looks quite a bit like me, you know. I think that's just one of those things that happens naturally, so I don't know that there's... Go ahead.
What I find really interesting with the portraits of famous stars way back when is what we find attractive tends to track throughout history.
Yeah.
You know, the same faces come back over and over again, and that's what we've always found attractive, because we can find evidence of it just with such as the Keanu Reeves portrait.
Mm-hmm.
You know, out of all of the portraits to save and stuff like that, somebody said, oh, he's good looking, we're going to save this one.
Uh-huh. That's interesting, actually. And that's the thing, you know, is a lot of them seem to also be, you know, very, I guess, important or influential figures from one life to the next, especially Keanu, you know. So it kind of leads in, I mean, is there a possibility that, you know, people are being cloned? I mean, if there's extraterrestrials messing with people's DNA, that could maybe, you know, that could come in there. I mean, there has been some guests that have said, you know, that some people are cloned, actually. You know, they take genetic material from people to create some more like them. I'm thinking that Sherry Wilde had said something about that. But guys, that's on the archive. You'd have to listen to the episode. I don't remember for sure if she had mentioned anything about that, but I know that she had mentioned something about them taking genetic material from people and creating children, you know, from
I believe it's possible, because you can take your pet and you can clone it.
Yeah.
I mean, that is something that is fact. That is what they are doing. They are for almost $500,000, I think it is.
Really?
Yeah.
You sure that wasn't in Total Recall or something?
No, they are doing it. It's out of an Asian country. It's either Japan or China. has a company where once your dog dies, you put it, you don't put it in the freezer, you put it in the refrigerator so that they can get a live tissue, so that they can get a good sample from your pet and they can clone it for you.
Wow. You know, yeah, you could clone the pet, but it's not going to have the same experiences. I mean, it's not going to have the same connections that your pet had with your family. You know, all of those experiences right. that you had leading up, you know, that made that's a part of what made that pet special and you know,
will
treasure
it
to your family.
Will it have the same soul or not?
I don't believe so. I don't think it's possible. And will it be soulless? That's another question. You know, will it actually have a soul? If it wasn't, you know, I don't know. That's a good question.
It must have some if they have a business out of it. If everyone was just getting a sort of vegetable pet back, they probably wouldn't.
Well, isn't that one of those things about like the voodoo zombies, though, is that, you know, they it's said that the voodoo priest can bring back the dead, but when they do, they have no soul. And so they, you know, they're not right.
A bit like Pet Sematary.
Kind of, well, yeah.
I'm not sure how it works exactly, but I do know that they take and they have a surrogate mother, basically. The dogs have a surrogate mother where the cloned embryo is placed into. And so the dog's born, grows up from infant into an adulthood with a whole, you know, different set of circumstances and life experiences from the other dogs. So I would think that there would be some individual identity between the two of them that separates them just because of the life experiences that mm-hmm. the animal's having that's different from the host.
Hmm. You guys but got me thinking.
If they're doing it to our pets already, you know, somewhere secretly they've already done it
with humans.
Yeah.
That's, I don't know how I feel about that. I know that for some people, I know that it would be desirable, especially people who have lost someone that they love, you know, and they just can't handle it. But it's not the same thing as bringing that person back. It just isn't. They don't have the memories. They don't have the experiences. They're not the same. I mean, they may look the same. Genetically, they may be the same. But you can't clone that. At least I don't believe so. That's, I don't think I like that idea.
Yeah. The individuality of each of us is mm-hmm. Maybe not something you can put a stamp on, really.
No.
Well, should we go on to the next topic?
There's a yes, let's do.
Because this one, I don't know if anyone will have anything to say about. Topic bot, yeah, just load it up.
The TV show Stranger Things.
Oh, yes, I was actually wanting to talk about this, Mark. That's perfect. Okay, so I'm only a few episodes in. I just started watching this, but oh my gosh, I love this. I love this show. It's got a very retro feel, but they did it right. I mean, it's almost like walking back in time. Have you seen this show, Melina?
Yes, I have seen the whole thing, and I'll try not to ruin it for you. but it is a good show, you know, and I love that it's like a book, you know, it has a beginning and it has an end and it doesn't leave you hanging for more, but they still leave it open. You know, they kind of still leave it a chance for it to be left open, but they neatly cinch everything up.
Oh, wow. So they actually did in one season, they did a full story.
Yeah, a full story. Wow. Each episode's a chapter. I loved it.
Yeah.
I have not seen it, or I've only heard about it. So is it based on, you know, is it conceivable sort of mysteries in it, stuff that interests you, or is it totally fiction?
It's fiction. It's paranormal. It's fiction. It's worth the watch. It has
Winona Ryder's in it.
Yeah, Winona Ryder's in it.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's really good. You know, halfway through you think, well, that's it, you know, but then it gets interesting.
Huh. Oh, I can't wait to get farther. Oh, stop me going now. Oh, man. Oh, I'm really eager to see the rest of this. I might have to binge watch.
That's what I did. I binge watched it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm trying to get the hubby into the show, you know, because it's more fun to watch it with someone. So I don't just want to watch it alone. So I'm working on getting him into it, you know, because it's more fun that way. It's what I did with Supernatural.
Are you both dead? Game of Thrones ladies.
I am now. I actually.
I've never seen it.
My kids got me to start watching it a few months ago, and so I naturally brought my husband in with me to watch a couple episodes, and we both got hooked like almost immediately, and we did binge watch that show. We binge watched that show through all the seasons. Oh my gosh. That's a really good show, actually. Game of Thrones is really good. Yeah, I'm wanting to read the books now, actually. You know, you see a good show and you think, well, you know, the book is always better than whatever comes out on film in any way, shape, or form. So I can't even imagine how amazing the books must be. So now I'm going to have to read the books. Yeah.
That's good. But that's why TopicBot, not me, asked about Stranger Things.
Well, you know what, though? Was there a book series for Stranger Things, Melina? Because
I don't know. I don't know.
As oftentimes, you know, series like that come from a book series. So I'm almost curious, you know, whether or not that might have come from, you know, some sort of a book series. That would be interesting. But, you know, Stranger Things had a Super 8 feel to it when I first started to watch that very first episode. You know, it was kind of, have you ever seen the film Super 8, Mark?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, it's got that feel to it, and they really captured the 1980s perfectly because that's the time frame that it's set in. It's set in 1983, and oh, it was like such a flashback, you know.
Back when the Bermuda Triangle was cool.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, exactly.
Back when everybody wasn't looking at their hands because that's where their phone is.
Back when watching a movie was a family event, you know, when HBO had the logo that comes swooping down the street, you know, and the music is playing and everybody gets all the popcorn ready and the blankets are out and you got your beanbag chairs and everybody's all snuggled up together, ready to watch that movie together as a family. Back then, well, that just doesn't happen hardly at all anymore, you know, everybody's all in their own little worlds, everybody's all separate and... You know, the more connected we are, I was saying this the other day to my husband, the more connected we are, the farther we are apart, all of us. And that's something that I've worked really hard to try to prevent from happening as much as possible with my family, you know. So we watch stuff together, you know. When we watch something, you know, I'm like, hey, you guys, you want to watch something? And so we do it all, you know. It's like, I don't want to play this game. It's like, no, come on. 2 hours. It's not going to kill you. And we'll watch something, you know, just family time is really important. And it's not a priority enough these days, but it needs to still be because those connections, you know, that's when you have that disconnect, you know, that's why, you know, you have these situations, you know, where kids just, you know, are always gone and they don't care because they don't feel, you know, like their parents really care. So you've got to tell them, hey, guys, let's spend some time, you know, so they know that you care. Because otherwise they're just going to be gone and they think the only people that care about them are their friends. You guys have got to remind your kids that you still care. You don't just, you know, give in and say, ah, I want to give them their freedom and just, you know, let go and just do everything. You've always got to make sure that your kids know that if they're willing to give some time, you want to spend that time. It's really important. Because that's one of those things that has caused that disconnect in our society. And we have the ability to mend it if we just take the effort to do so. Okay, topic bot. Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't matter if it's Game of Thrones, Stranger Things, or Two and a Half Men.
Just exactly.
Spend the time.
Yeah.
I think topic bot might have one more.
Okay.
Alert. Interesting topic. Found.
Is it?
Hillary Clinton. Clinton.
It killed Topic Bot. She killed Topic Bot. I think Topic Bot was scheduled to testify against her. He just died mysteriously.
Yeah. You've had a big week for that, have you not?
Mm.
Is Melina? There anything you want
Melina,
to say about
you
it?
Want to say something? She must have something. Melina, something. Please, anything.
She doesn't.
No.
I think the best I can offer is...
oh, no. There we are. Oh, we just lost her. That's why. We just... yeah. It's like the call is kind of funky. So...
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to catch up on that situation because there was a... the BBC are very picky and choosy about what articles they let people comment on there. And this was one of them. And I saw a poll on Twitter today, and Trump was doing pretty strongly on an opinion poll.
Really? I'm not surprised. Not surprised at all. I've been, every chance I get, I've been reminding people that we don't have the lesser of two evils, and we don't only have one female candidate. And let me see if I can find this website real quick, because... I think it's Open Politics or something like that. But there's a website that you can go to. I know I've mentioned it before, but this website has a quiz that you can take, right? And you go through it, and step by step, you answer each issue on, you know, how you feel about it, right? So people think that they, you know, they've supported or they've picked, you know, the candidate that is best suited to them. But, you know, I don't know how well everybody's looked up each candidate and where they actually truly stand on each of these issues. So there's this website. It takes you through a list of questions on every topic, you know, ranges from, you know, social reform to the wars. It talks about healthcare system. It talks about our troops. It talks about every feasible. It even talks about abortion, the economy, how we're going to, what we're going to do for education spending and things like that. And once you've answered every last one of those questions, it calculates what your percentages are in relation to each candidate and what their views are on every topic. And then it will tell you who you align with. For me, it was Jill Stein. And until this had actually come up, and it's funny because it was a different candidate. It was actually Gary Johnson that suggested this, right? So I take the quiz and I don't align with Gary Johnson. And I knew I didn't. I knew that there were several of the issues that I disagreed with him on. But I certainly wasn't voting for Clinton, and I certainly wasn't voting for Trump. And so, you know, at that time, I was putting most of my support behind Gary Johnson. But come to find out, after I fill out this survey, that I found out about Jill Stein, who is the Green Party candidate. And so I have been supporting her ever since. Her views are very, well, they're Green Party views. I mean, she's fully aligned with the Green Party, which means, you know, she supports ending the wars. She supports education reform almost to the level that you guys have over there. And, you know, she plans on cutting military spending budgets that are absolutely ridiculous to help pay for, you know, the new education system. She actually has a plan in place, you know, to how to actually make these things happen. And I don't think people realize, you know, like the bank bailouts. She plans on, you know, not bailing out the banks and instead bailing out her kids and, you know, forgiving the student loans, you know, so they don't have to spend their whole lives paying off that debt.
Well, this is the thing. From this side, or just my own naive view, it seems that, you know, the majority are still sort of in favor of just same business, different day. The old, well, you know how here in the UK there's been sort of rifts in the in politics, and a clear vibe that people are not so impressed with modern day politics, but it just seems like business as usual in the USA. In comes some new career politicians or whoever, and that'll be it. And didn't you do all that like Occupy Wall Street stuff?
Trump
and Clinton seem to be.
And there was a media blackout over most of it.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, a lot of it just didn't.
And well, that's the thing, you see, on this side of the pond, the media are having less and less of an effect. What they're doing, in fact, is actually turning the favor in the opposite direction.
Mm-hmm.
That's fact. And that's what this Trump thing that I saw about Apollo earlier, it seemed to suggest.
Well, it's very
whatever
misleading.
The media try and do and try and say, then everyone else will just go against them. Or they will in this country. I don't know where you're getting that.
I know.
In America.
I mean, the fact that Hillary won out over Sanders, you know, alone was one of those things that showed that there was corruption there. And it doesn't seem to matter how much corruption is shown, it just gets ignored. It's completely ignored. And it's astounding. I mean, it's literally flabbergasting that all of these things can be brought to light and nothing is done. Nothing. And, oh, the other things, by the way, listeners, that Jill Stein also plans on doing is repealing the Patriot Act and the NDAA and pretty much all of the other unconstitutional things that have been passed recently. She's going to work towards those. She's also going to pardon Snowden and also give him a cabinet seat. Yeah.
I remember reading that one. Yeah.
So if you're wondering who to vote for, I would suggest Jill Stein. If you don't want to support Hillary and you don't want to support Trump, Stein is the way to go, guys. Stein is the way to go. And so there's a story that I want to touch on tonight before we go to our next game. There is an island located in the Bay of Bengal between Myanmar and Indonesia. It's home to an isolated tribe that has never been colonized. It's never had any contact with human beings other than resulting in their death, pretty much. These people are one of the last Stone Age tribes on Earth whose culture has been completely untouched by modern civilization. I certainly can't blame them for the way they react. But despite the fact that this island belongs to India formally, no one dares to go near it, and no one will approach it. The Sentinelese tribe, I guess, is what they're called. And the reason that nobody will go near it is because of their extreme violence and hostility that they have toward anyone who ever tries to come ashore. They're either attacked or killed. Even a helicopter. They attacked a helicopter that had attempted to get near the island. They threw spears and arrows at it. There was a body found, apparently, of someone who had, I guess, had a makeshift raft and their throat was cut. There was a ship that ran aground. And now I think there was one instance where they didn't kill them, but they didn't actually get to interact with the tribe. But people are saying that because of how isolated they are, that they are the most at risk to be wiped out by an epidemic, because of the fact that they've not had any interaction with outer civilizations at all. I think the thing about the story that I found so interesting is, like, when they attacked the helicopter that just hovered near them, they were throwing stones and arrows at it and spears. You know what this reminded me of, guys? There was an analogy that appeared in my mind with, in relation to these people and their response to everyone from the outside world, many of which, you know, were just trying to make contact, maybe help them or do whatever. Although you know how that goes. It never ends well anyway. So they were probably right in doing so. But this island of people, this tribe of people who are untouched, made me think of our planet. When you think about the way the governments of our planet react whenever there is an approach by an intelligence from outside of our planet, what do? We attack it, like, you know, because we have no knowledge of them. We don't know, so we feel threatened. And so what do? We attack. They have always attacked. Look at the Battle of LA. Look what happened there. And that was, I think, the most publicized visitation that we ever had. And what do? They didn't do anything to us, just like the helicopter. They just hovered there on the coast of Los Angeles. We fired missiles at them. We bombarded them, and they just stood there. They didn't attack us. They didn't do anything back. They just sat there while we tried to attack them, and then they went away. This island tribe is exactly like our planet right now. Every time an outsider tries to come, we get scared and we try to attack them. And like that, I mean, they're going to remain at the same level that they're at. And maybe that's where they should be. But the same is true for us. If we continue to attack outsiders from other planets, from other worlds, from other dimensions, when they approach us, we are never going to make that next step and take that next step and go beyond what we currently are at. And I just wanted to share that tonight, guys, because it really struck me, you know, as an interesting correlation between the tribe and our planet and our world leaders right now, because they behave the exact same way as the tribesmen behave when faced with outsiders. And I don't know, you know, per se, if that's a good or a bad thing, but I don't think it's going to help us in the long run to just try to attack everything that comes our way. I don't think it will. I don't know. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, the tribe, I presume, would have some sort of structure in it. Like, you know, some of the people will be, it will be their task to look after the village or whatnot.
Right.
And in a similar fashion, that would be like, as you say, the superpowers of the earth. They are the militaristic might that reacts in this way. But us, you and me, we would not choose to do that, would we?
No.
We would be more open arms. So for all they know, the people, the ships that didn't make it, is, you know, they only ever experienced the guards of this tribe.
Right.
Maybe there were wiser and calmer
people on the
whatever you might
interior of
it.
The island that would have been open to meeting outsiders.
Yeah. In the case of like aliens and other worlds and things, well, that's a tricky one because clearly they do things which face militaristic might, like, well, you know plenty of examples of that, but they do also do things apparently where they will just communicate or meet or give clues.
I don't think
people.
Aggression is, you know, the best reflex response.
But then I personally think the military get, maybe they do know more, but I think they get that thrown back in their face. Maybe the normal people, maybe the people who aren't in that structure do actually have more of the knowledge about these things than like the governments do. I'd like to explain that further, but I really can't.
Okay, we'll leave it at that then. Melina, are you with us?
I am, I'm here. I think it's amazing that we still have some our cultures in our civilization that are still Stone Age.
Right.
You know, I would be frightened to wash up on their shores.
Oh, yeah.
Considering
I would
welcome they them. Give others.
Yeah. I wouldn't push
you
them.
Know, but that's the same thing with the hypothesis of aliens, if they are here, which I do believe that they are, we have no real knowing as to whether or not we should be open arms.
Right. Like I said, with the Battle of L.A., that was one of the, you know, that was one of those things that kind of showed, even though we attacked them, they didn't attack back. I think there's something to be said there, you know. I mean, that's a sign.
Well, it's interesting. It's how we deal with it, because as you say, most people will react negatively, perhaps. But take the Rendlesham UFO encounter in this country, mm-hmm. and one of the soldiers, I mean, there's various versions of the story, and you have to right. dig for the actual real one, I think, but he jumped into it. He ran to the UFO and jumped into it or something, because he wanted to know more, which is a very good trait in my view, and if more people were like that, we might actually have a few more answers, but
yeah,
we don't, and unfortunately yeah. what came to him after that was not very nice, but he was like tortured for information or something like that. So not good, but you're right, this notion of, well, just being more open-armed.
Yeah. Oh, I think that's an extreme. I mean, just jumping into their ship, you know, when they haven't actually said, you know, hey, how are you doing? Or something. It's one extreme or another. It's either attack or just, you know, jump in without knowing. I think we have to, you know, exercise some amount of caution. Obviously, you know, it shouldn't just be, you know, like, hey, you know, in your face. Because just like I think we have, you know, aggressive people and nurturing people, I'm sure that other species are the same. There are some that are aggressive and some that aren't, some that are benevolent. So I think it's, you know, it's something you have to take case by case.
Definitely. But for someone like that, and I don't know how this quite applies to the tribes people, but his, you know, he was there on the spot and this thing was in front of him. He may have felt something at the time.
Yeah.
Whereas the people you're saying, you know, take this drastic action, these are the ones who, you know, they hear there's something going on miles away and then they'll probably watch it on radar and they'll phone each other around and do all this. It's like they're not in the heat of the moment. They get the chance and the time to make these, you know, drastic, right. you know, slightly off decisions of gunning them down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm not sure about how much notice they had, because it was pretty low, the craft that that was over Los Angeles back, I think it was 1942. I think it was pretty low. And it was in February, I believe, when it happened.
Absolutely, but hadn't there been sort of not exactly the same, but they had been keeping an eye on the sky, had they not?
Well, there had been lots of activity during that time period. I mean, that whole era, there was lots of stuff. And until the Roswell crash, you know, there was no, you know, actual physical, you know, interactions with a craft as far as on the ground, you know, previous to that. So this was probably the closest they came.
One of the good things, not good things, but the finer points of that is that bullets actually went near this thing, whatever it was, whereas mm-hmm. in more recent times, you know, airplane things shut down when they get close to anything like
yeah.
this. And missile silos get shut down and that. So.
Well, now, see, I think that's something totally different. I think that's them trying to, I think, let us know that, you know, they're not going to let us destroy the planet is what I think that's about. That's one of those things that, you know, I don't think we've talked about it enough, but when the UFOs visit our military installations and they shut down our missile silos, you know, and they power them down, people see that as an act of aggression. I don't see it that way. What I see is that they're concerned about us destroying ourselves and destroying each other. And it's their way of just letting us know, hey, you know, knock it off. You know, yeah, you've got your toys and you want to play with them, but we have the power to ground you if we have to keep you from destroying everything and everyone. That's my view on it. That's what I think is, you know, that's what I think they're trying to say or get across to us.
Yep, but they said something slightly different with the LA case, didn't they? They didn't shut any weapons down.
No, like I mean, but that was, you know, that was beforehand, and that was probably, I don't know that that was their first interaction with us, but it was certainly one that they learned from, because it told them that we're aggressive. You know, it told them that, you know, this race, you know, doesn't necessarily, they're not open to communication in a traditional sense.
Mm.
Which is unfortunate. You know, we might have declared war.
Very true, but then we have all continued to have sightings long since the Battle of LA.
Well, yeah, but like I said, I think there's so many other races that are visiting us, and it's there's a lot of people, you know, that are, you know, government insiders that have said as much as well. That there's, you know, Clifford Stone. Remember, he was on ATS, and he talked about, you know, how through his experiences in the military, you know, he knew of at least 80 different species of extraterrestrial that were visiting the planet that were documented, and, you know, they were basically, you know, they had a file on each of them, you know, describing them and what they knew about them. And if what he said was true, which I tend to think it probably was, I don't know if it's quite that large of a number, but I think it's possible, you know, we're grouping a whole bunch of different species under one label, which isn't quite fair, because we see them, you know, and we think, oh, you know, that's another gray or something, but it could be anything you see when you see a craft. And I think that's why there are so many different types of UFOs that are seen. You know, we have different kinds of cars, you know, so they have different kinds of vehicles too, but I don't think it's all the same race. I think that's why we see different types of vehicles. There are different types of functions that they have, but they're also from different places, you know, so I think that's why we see so many different craft, and I think that's also why, you know, even when some may have experienced with us nothing but aggression, maybe others, you know, haven't had the same experience, although unfortunately I think they probably have, you know, for the most part. I'm not sure how Valiant Thor ended up at the Pentagon. I don't know how he arrived and how he managed to actually get a meeting, but the story of Valiant Thor, if allegedly it's true, is one that gives me hope that even though we have behaved badly, that they have not given up on us and they're still willing to help. And, you know, these radio signals, they go out everywhere. So hopefully, if you're out there, Valiant Thor, and you're still listening, we're not all like that.
Yeah.
So we have another game, right? We can play.
We do. I think we've got time for it.
Okay.
Yep.
Melina, are you ready?
Oh, is Melina there?
I am here, and okay. I am ready.
All right.
Good. Okay. Yes. Let's dumb the entire radio station down with some guess.
Yeah. Guess the creature.
Okay.
Three clues. You each get to, you get, what am I saying? On each clue, you will get a chance to either pass or give the answer. The okay. first clue, because it's the hardest, will get you most points. The last clue will get you the least points. So it's whoever gets the most points in the end. So remember, you have to, it might be tactful to pass the first clue or because you can't go again if you get it wrong. Okay?
Okay.
So the first one. Let's.
The first clue is.
With no natural source of nourishment, I must devour stray humans for sustenance. Om nom nom.
What?
Quite hard. So I'm. Humans for sustenance. So, Lenita, you going to pass or try and give an answer?
I'm going to pass.
Okay, Mel? Mel.
Okay, I'm here. If I give an answer, do I have to stay with it or do I get another?
Yes. You will have to stay with your answer.
So I can pass.
Yep.
I think I know what it is, but I'll pass. Let's hear one more clue.
Okay. So for 10 points then.
Clue. The second clue is...
If you're lucky, you might find me dwelling deep within a spooky labyrinth.
Oh, Minotaur.
What creature is this?
That's a Minotaur.
You're going with Minotaur. Mel?
I think Minotaur is a really good answer, but I'll go vampire.
Vampire. Oh. Okay, the final clue.
The third and final clue is...
I was once described by a Roman poet as being part bull, part man.
Yay!
That was a Minotaur.
So, Winnie... Good going, but yeah, Lanita wins that round.
Okay.
Points?
Correct. This creature was the Minotaur.
Okay.
Next creature. Mm. First clue for 15 points.
The first clue is...
I was born on March the 1st, 1994, in Canada.
Either of you want to go guess that one?
A creature with a birthday?
So, Lanita, pass or an answer?
I'm passing.
Passing?
Pass. No? Pass. Pass.
Passing too. Okay, let's move straight on to clue.
The second clue is...
My middle name is Drew, and my favorite type of music is teen pop.
So what creature is this? Anything?
Is it Justin Bieber?
Bill's going with Justin Bieber. Anita?
I'm going to agree. I'm going to say Justin Bieber too.
Okay, so
the third and final clue is...
As a young and talented music artist, I have had success with 3 number ones in the U.S., all from the same album.
Yeah, gonna give that one to Mel. 10 points. You were absolutely...
Well done.
Correct. This creature was Justin Bieber. Ta-da!
And a final one then. Final creature. First clue, here we go, for 15.
The first clue is...
I'm 10 feet tall, I have wings, and I swoop down, and I go squawk, and then I fly around even more, and perch on some things, and then squawk again, and I'm being cool, and, like, stuff.
What?
Any idea? 15 points, what creature? Perches and things.
Pass.
Male's passing. This could clinch you the game.
I know. Thunderbird.
Do you want to go with Thunderbird?
I'm going to go with Thunderbird.
In an effort for 15 points, let's go to the next clue. Male, you're still in the game.
Clue is...
I suppose when I'm not squawking or perching, I'm apparently making the Silver Bridge collapse in 1967, killing 46 people.
Oh,
the Mothman.
Does that help?
No.
It's the Mothman.
Yeah, she's right.
The third and final clue is...
Famous sightings of me perching on things in West Virginia. Some witnesses would say I'm part man, part moth. That's part moth, part man. Man, moth, man, moth, me, that's me.
Well, points on that one.
Mel wins.
Correct. This creature was Mothman.
Yay. Good job, Mel.
And there's no need for a tiebreak. Mel wins.
Yay. Okay, so... you know, every week I draw a winner. I had to draw a winner off show last week, so it was posted only on Twitter. But we have the contest for copies of the audiobook, The Frequency, which is my most recent release on Audible. And so we have a number of Twitter entries, and I am going to use a random name picker from miniwebtool.com to pick a name. So I'm putting the pick random name right now. And it is at LoriFisher28_. So congratulations, LoriFisher28. And then we'll do one more. So let's do one more. And Bruce53339476. Congratulations. Okay, you guys. Just inbox me on Twitter. Because you're both following me, so I will get those, and I will get you your information and your codes so you can get your free copies of The Frequency. Yes. All right. So, we've got that. If you guys haven't entered yet, you can still enter for next week's drawing. Just go to Twitter and go to twitter.com/NitaWho, or just search at NitaWho, and that'll bring you up. And at the very top of the page of my Twitter page, pinned is the tweet for giving away. All you have to do is follow my Twitter and retweet that tweet, and it gets you entered. And then we'll draw two more names next week. And that's it. And okay, for any of you guys out there that's listening, if you've missed any episodes, we have a YouTube channel. Which you can find a link to the YouTube channel on our website, which is anomalousrealities.com. So if you go to anomalousrealities.com, it has a link not only to, it's got a link to our Facebook page, it's got a link to our Twitter, and it also has a link to our YouTube, which is also where we have all of our archives. And that is, for those of you listening, that's youtube.com/C/anomalousrealitiesradio. Which the C is for channel. Yeah. So, and you know, just like you do with the station, when you guys go there, on the right hand side, there is a support channel. If you like the show and you want to donate, you can do so on the YouTube page. You can click the support button and donate something. And so we are at 5 minutes till, which is normally, when our music comes in and cues us that it's, you know, the end of our show. But I think something's going on tonight because I'm not hearing the music. It's not happening like it normally does. So I guess we'll just say our good nights, right? And then we will let the station go to the next host for the next show. So thank you, everyone, for listening to us tonight. And I hope you've enjoyed all of our topics. And make sure and give us a like and a follow and join us. And thanks, Mark and Melina, for being with us. If you guys want to say goodnight to everybody.
Good night.
Thank you and good night.
And that is it from all of us. Have a wonderful weekend, everyone. Good night.